Chad and I actually met years ago through a mutual friend, Sean Smith, through Lakeside Golf Club. And then Chad and I instantly hit it off and actually played quite a bit of volleyball together, played in some beach and also some grass tournaments together. And so that's how we became very close friends. Chad just had a passion for everything in life. And whether it was volleyball, any other types of sports, and he was a guy that wanted to start the game first in the morning and wanted to play till dark. And so I just really, you know, have fond memories of the time that we spent together playing in the tournaments. We'd play from morning till night, and it was just fantastic. He had just a great spirit and passion for life. This is our 9th annual tournament, and we started it in Chad's memory. He was a very good volleyball player, very skilled player, and so we put together a group of guys every year that really like to come out in his memory, play volleyball, and Chad would have been a kid in a candy store on a day like this. It's just right down his alley. And so we keep doing it every year in his memory. It keeps growing. We started the tournament initially at Lakeside, and then we moved it down to Zuma Beach, and this is the second year at Hermosa Beach. So the tournament just continues to grow, and we have wonderful people that help out with the tournament, and just continues to blossom.
Do you sometimes shake your head at what Aris has been able to accomplish, kind of on the other side of this foundation, just that she's been able to raise awareness for a cause that, had kind of been under the cover of night?
She's incredible. And her commitment and dedication to the foundation is fabulous. Being in New York, coming out for events like this here on the West Coast, she's just always there. And so it's just amazing. Slowly but surely, she's been able to make progress, and she just has a determination to never stop.
And don't call me Shirley.
Okay, honey.
When I'm with Kurt and calling the brothers, a lot of times I'll go, hey, what do you think Chad would have done in this situation and in that situation? So he's here. You just can't see him, is the way I feel. But, it's one of those things. You just got to kind of tuck away your memories and bring them back when you come around these people and reflect from time to time and look at the pictures and think of all the good times. Mm-hmm. So it's a nice occasion. For people who don't know him, he's just one of those type people that you automatically feel like you've known him for years. He was very unbiased. You could be black, white, yellow, green. He made the best of every situation. He talked to everybody. And just wanted to know what you were about. He very seldom spoke about himself. He always wanted to know what was going on in your head. What do you think, Jay? What do you think about this? What do you think about that? What would you do? Just endless curiosity and endless knowledge of history. world wars all the way back to, you know, the beginning of time. He knew it all.
It's more than just the number. This has a tremendous impact emotionally on the community, because you have the athlete who's sort of the pinnacle of health dying suddenly of an unrecognized heart problem. And this obviously is this tragic disaster for the family, but also impacts the whole community. But, you know, so we strove to try to work with the Los Angeles School District specifically to make them aware that there are certain athletes who may have some symptoms that would indicate they possibly have a heart problem. And the main thing we worry about is people who pass out during exertion. You know, and that's what we always warn people, that people who pass out when they're exercising need to be evaluated by a cardiologist. Sadly, sometimes the first symptom is the only symptom someone will have.
Like Chad,
yeah. What happens basically is the heart muscle has a subtle but very serious abnormality, and the right combination of circumstances cause the heart to start beating very irregularly and not pump blood effectively. And after about 3 minutes of the heart not beating effectively, that basically is no longer compatible with survival. So there's not a long warning time, not a lot of response time. So our efforts are to try to raise people's awareness, to do some screening efforts. The primary test we're using for screening is an ultrasound, which bounces some sound waves off the heart back to a receiver and allows us to reconstruct a very accurate image of the heart. It allows us to know if the heart muscle is weakened, if there are any abnormalities in the heart valves, and at times if there are any problems with the coronary arteries. So it's a very comprehensive cardiac exam. It takes a little bit of time and expertise to do this. There aren't that many physicians. We have special technologists actually that are trained to do this.
I had what's called Wolff-Parkinson-White syndrome, and that is a condition with the electrical impulses of the heart. And the condition basically causes me to become winded through playing sports, and through the process of being tested, the doctors found that I had some irregularity in the way that my heart was beating, so they recommended that I go do some additional battery of tests, which revealed that I had this condition. And fortunately for me, the condition was fixable. There's a bona fide fix. Now there are no limitations to what I can do. Before, in fact, it's interesting, because one of the guys that I played with, Mark, he noticed a couple of years before, when I had the condition, he noticed that I would play really well the first two games, and then the rest of the day I would really play terribly, and he wondered, he's like, what's up with Troy? How come he's so good in the very beginning, and then he plays so terribly after that? And it was as a result of this WPW syndrome that I had, and, you know, I mean, obviously I feel lucky because, A, it was detected early because it could lead to other problems later, and, B, it's something that is totally correctable. I do serve on another nonprofit board, and my term is coming up soon, and I'm already kind of setting the table to actually bring this type of testing to, you know, the school district and place where I grew up and where my kids are going to school, because honestly, I played volleyball. I played intercollegiate volleyball, Division I volleyball at USC, and it was very difficult for me. It was an undiagnosed problem at that time, and it was brutal, you know, for me. I was trying to overcome that. And it was very difficult. I didn't get to play at my full potential. So, I mean, there's still something there where I wished I had it diagnosed and fixed earlier. So it's kind of becoming, in my mind, you know, a personal crusade to bring this type of testing to other kids, because, A, there are other kids that could die prematurely, and B, there are other kids like me that perhaps could have the problem fixed and have a, you know, a good athletic career. I feel totally blessed to have had intervention for, you know, where where the intervention may not have occurred because of a cause such as this. It's definitely changed my life. So, you know, from a civic responsibility, from a community, you know, sense of things, yeah, I feel a debt, or, you know, that I want to give back in some way, and I feel that that's one of the ways that at least I have designs on helping.
you've known Arista for a little while. Do you marvel at her energy and her ability to marshal forces like this together?
She's awesome. I mean, it's just, it's amazing. I mean, you get near her and you just share off of the energy and you just, you know, you want to do stuff. So she's ramping up with some different things and is actually going to have me perhaps, help her, do some speaking engagements and things like that. So I'm totally excited and at the ready to help out with it. If I can help in any way, even, to save one kid's life or to help one kid with what I had, it would be worth it. So, I'm excited about that and really happy to, happy to have her as a friend.
Tim Karp is alive today because of early screening at Children's Hospital Los Angeles. He has the same type of cardiomyopathy Chad had.
For myself, I would probably definitely be a statistic if I hadn't been diagnosed at an early age because I am an individual who tries to push myself.
Despite CM, Tim mountain bikes and stays very active. Some cardiomyopathy patients may need heart transplants. Others, like Tim, manage just fine with medication and lifestyle changes.
Diagnosing them early and knowing exactly what they have allows us to sort of tailor the therapy a little bit more and therefore maximize both their quality and quantity of life.
Into an athlete dying young, A.E. Hausman wrote, "The time you won your town the race, we cheered you through the marketplace. Man and boy stood cheering by. And home we brought you, shoulder high."
At Chad's church service, I will always remember a vision of his brothers and his friends, all athletes, carrying with such pride and dignity his casket out of the church. And they were so proud of their friend. And I think that's all you can do. They knew that Chad was the best inspiration that they had. He did the best with what years he had. I hope I live an emotional and physically satisfying life. I hope I'm healthy till the end. I hope I'm lucid in mind and soul, and that I reach all my untapped potential. I hope I bring happiness to others. I hope I leave my mark on this world and will be remembered as a solid contributing citizen with honor and loving and dignity. I hope I leave a rich legacy to my family. So we all feel that all of Chad's wishes did come true.
Some dreams.